Very good morning to class 10th D. So we have recited the poem Amanda yesterday. We have learned the theme based on the poem Amanda also. Fine. And I tried sharing the screen yesterday. Still some students are joining. Let them join. So I would like to share the screen with you all. And then I will discuss the theme which is written on the board, and then we'll continue with the question answers. Okay. Because we have done it yesterday only. The whole, because it's a very, you know, short poem, but carrying the very big message. That's up to you how you take it. Let me have the privilege to show you this. Now you just send me the feedback if my screen is visible to you all. Harsimran, same. My screen is visible. Okay, now you can see, what do you see, Sam, on the screen? You tell me. What do you see on the screen?
A girl is biting her nails.
Okay, fine. So it's quite visible to you. A girl is biting the nail. That picture I have shared. So those who were absent yesterday, I'm going to give you a small gist of this poem once again, Amanda. So Amanda is actually the name of a girl, a little girl. And, you know, they have not mentioned the age of the girl in this poem. But one hint is there that the girl is, I guess, in between the age of 10 to 12. She's not a teenager. She's not a toddler also, because, you know, the kind of actions she's doing and the kind of, you know, stories she's acquainted with. She is known to Rapunzel. She mentions Rapunzel. She mentions mermaid in the water. She mentions the word orphan, and she's biting her nails and she does not sit properly. So these kinds of habits we can associate from the age group of 10 to 12. So this is our estimation age of the girl. We do not know the exact age. Okay. So there is a little girl named Amanda in this poem. And, you know, she is constantly pointed out by her mother. Fine. And again, once again, one thing is that they have not mentioned that mother is doing this, mother is saying. And this is quite obvious that most of the mothers only, you know, take care of children at home. So this is a common phenomena throughout the world, that mothers are there to point out the children, you know, as compared to father. So that's why this is again obvious that mother is being mentioned here indirectly. So age also and mother, that thing also. Still students are joining. See, these things, you know, kind of distraction to the teacher also. In between, they keep on coming. So Amanda is the poem written by Robin Kleene, fine, a poetess. And she has expressed the views of a little girl named Amanda in this. Actually, Amanda is representing all the children here. It's not that about one girl named Amanda. It's about all the children of the world. She's representing all. And mother is representing all the parents, not only mothers. Fine. So mother being mentioned in this poem is she's representing all the parents in the world. Clear? So Robin Kleene has expressed the views of a little girl named Amanda, who is constantly being pointed out by her mother for making mistakes. Fine. When she bites her nails, her mother points her out. Fine. You can see in the picture, I have just saved some pictures so that you can have pictorial description in your mind. When her mother points her out that you keep on biting your nails, she says, her mother says, you can say, don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Hunch means bend. You can see in this picture, the posture of the girl. She is sitting in a, like I say, bend, shoulders are bent. She's not sitting properly. So mother points her out again. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. When she bites the nail, she's being pointed out. When she bends her nails, she's being pointed out. Fine. Now, stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. So in the first stanza, poetess has expressed that mother is giving instructions to the daughter, Amanda, that sit up straight. Don't sit in a lazy way. Slouching means sitting in a very lazy manner. Yesterday, we have done each and every word meaning. So if you have missed anything or if you were absent, please note down again. Clear? Hunch means to bend, and slouching means sitting in a very lazy manner. So mother is pointing out the daughter for biting the nails, for sitting up by bending the shoulder, for sitting lazily and sitting idly. So she's scolding her. And then what happens in the bracket, they have mentioned there is a languid emerald sea where the sole inhabitant is me, a mermaid drifting blissfully. So what does the response of Amanda to this? She imagines herself to be a mermaid. Can you see mermaid on the screen? Yes, Parina? Okay, fine. So you can see a mermaid on the screen. She imagines herself. Who imagines? Amanda imagines herself to be a mermaid. And she imagines ki better, I should be a mermaid. And I should be the only inhabitant. Inhabitant means resident. There should be no other fish or no other mermaid or no other dolphin or any other creature into the waters. I should be the only sole creature in that water. Fine. And I should be, she's saying that where the sole inhabitant is me, there is a languid emerald sea. Languid means relaxed. The meaning of languid is relaxed. Emerald is green color. So she's thinking there is a big, huge, green colored sea and only I am the one who's floating into it in a relaxed way, and water waves are floating and I'm just carried away in a very relaxed manner. And I should be drifting blissfully. Drifting means carried slowly by the water. Blissfully means happily. Clear? So this is the answer given by Amanda. Then in the next picture, let me just discuss another stanza. After that, clear? Did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? Let me show that picture where mother is scolding. So mother is scolding the daughter. You can see on the screen, that mother is scolding and pointing out mistakes of Amanda. She's saying that, did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? I thought I told you to clean your shoes, Amanda. So within, you can say, consecutive lines, she's giving n number of instructions to her. Fine, she's giving n number of instructions. But did you finish your homework? Did you clean your room? Did you clean your shoes? Did you, you know, maintain hygiene over there and all? So a lot of instructions are being given to this young girl. And Amanda was so disheartened after this. She imagines again herself to be an orphan. So she, in the bracket, they have written, I am an orphan. Orphan means the person whose parents are dead. Fine. Orphan is the child whose parents are no more. A child whose parents are dead. So she imagines herself to be an orphan, roaming the street. I should be an orphan. Better the situation will be that. My mother keeps on scolding me, keeps on pointing out to me, keeps on nagging me. Fine. And snubbing me. And she says, I should be an orphan. If I'll be an orphan, there will be no restriction upon me. I can wander wherever I want to. I can go into the streets. No restrictions will be imposed upon me. So then I pattern soft dust with my hushed bare feet. Mother is asking, did you clean your shoes, Amanda? And Amanda is imagining that I do not want to wear shoes even. I want to remain bare feet. Nange paav rehna chahti hai wo. She does not want to wear shoes. Mother wants her to behave in a very nice way, nice conduct as per the societal norms. But she says, I pattern soft dust with my hushed bare feet. I do not want to wear shoes and I want to use my feet to make the patterns in the dust. She wants to play with the sand. She wants to play in the dust. Fine. Usko mitti mein khelna hai. And mother is asking her to make clean the dust and wear the shoes and be, you know, all the time you cannot be very particular. All the time you cannot be live up to the societal norms. Fine. So she is feeling oppressed. She is feeling suffocated by too many instructions. Okay. So she imagines herself to be an orphan. Clear? Clear to everyone? So mother is keep on giving instructions again. Then mother says, don't eat that chocolate, Amanda. Remember your acne, Amanda? Will you please look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? See, the girl is not looking at the mother. Mother is looking at the girl in this picture. Acne means pimples on the face. You know that, fine? And she is giving instructions that you need not eat that chocolate, you will get the acne on the face. Why are you doing this? Why are you not looking into my eyes? I'm talking to you. Why are you behaving like that? So many instructions again, and Amanda feels disheartened. Then in the, you can say, in this picture, she imagines herself to be beautiful Rapunzel. Now, this is the character, beta. One character, one princess was there. The story is like that, that there was one princess whose name was Rapunzel, and she was having very long, beautiful hair. She was kept in a huge tower. You can see the picture of the tower here. So she was kept in one in the tower by one of the witch. You can see witch is there by holding the scissors in her hands, fine. So that witch has kept Rapunzel in that tower, and there was no staircase on the tower. There was no elevator on the tower. Nobody could reach that tower. Only witch could reach by climbing through the hair. So she was having so long hair. So this is fiction only, okay? So this is one fairy tale in English literature. So she imagines, now I told you that she might be in the age of 10 to 12. So she is imagining herself to be princess. Teenagers and adults, they do not, have that kind of bent of mind that they will talk about the princess, fine. So she's, very young, and that's why she's imagining herself to be Rapunzel. So she says, I am Rapunzel. Look at the books, beta. I'm Rapunzel. I have not a care. Life in a tower is tranquil and rare. She says that life in the tranquil means peace. Rare, strange. She's saying, yes, this is the life I want. I just want to be like Rapunzel. This is metaphor exactly. I'm Rapunzel. I don't want to care about people. I don't want to live with others. And she says, I want to live in a tower, in a peaceful life, a rare life. I will certainly never let down my bright hair. And if I will be having such bright hair, I will never let my hair down from that window. Clear? Then after that, fine, so she is very dejected. Send me thumbs up if it is clear to you all. Send me thumbs up if, because we have discussed already yesterday. So now please note down, themes written on the board now. So all of you are saying yes, ma'am, accordingly. So please note down. Poem is written by Robin Kleene. Remember that, fine. Poetess. Robin Kleene is not a male poet. She's female. First is constant controlling habit of parents. So this is one of the themes. Constant controlling habit of parents. Not all, but many parents, they have the habit of constant control. They want to have the remote control of the child in their own hands, and they want to give too many instructions. The way we change the channel, they want to change the behavior. Fine. Yes, we should be good enough. But it should not be too much that the students or you can say the children start feeling suffocated. So this is one of the themes. Next is struggles faced by children. This is a very important theme, that struggles, many struggles are faced by children which are not talked about. Children are never, when the children talks into the matters of the elder, they say, aap toh bhi bachche ho, you need not talk. Okay, when they behave in a childish way, they say, aap toh itne bade ho gaye ho, why are you behaving like a child? Fine. So dubious attitude is shown to the children. So they are never taken care of that. So too many instructions are also given to them. So their brain cannot, accept too many instructions. They need their space sometimes, not all the time, but they need their space. They need their freedom. So next theme is following societal norms. So why the parents keep on giving instructions? They want their children to follow societal norms. There's a particular set of behavior, social conduct, that you should behave like this, you should behave like that. Society kya bolegi, you should do this, you should sit like this, a girl should speak like that, a boy should do like this. So there are man-made restrictions actually. Fine. So following societal norms, and that is affecting our children. The next is children should never be deprived of their freedom. Very important poem, theme of this poem. That children should never be deprived of their freedom. Constant controlling by the parents, struggles faced by children. And third one, the basic themes. Children should never be deprived of their freedom. Let them breathe into the free air, let them relish, and you can say let them explore the outer world, let them do what they want sometimes, fine, they will also enjoy that. They will be responsible, rather, you know, when they are given the responsibility to choose their dresses, when they are given the responsibility of making career choices, they will be more responsible. The next is responsible upbringing. So this is a very good message for all the parents, that they should be very responsible parents. They need to give responsible upbringing. We should not look upon others, okay, unka bachcha kya kar raha hai, okay, that child is so obedient. We are not, robots, we are not machines that on the press of the green button, we will speak, on the red button, we will stop. Too many instructions cannot be handled by children. So they should be, yes, they should be given good upbringing, good mannerism, but too many instructions at a time can harm. They will turn into rebellions, you know. Wo fir har cheez pe oppose karenge parents ko, agar hum zyada unko control karenge. So that should be avoided. Responsible, you can say, upbringing is required. Okay, so these are the themes. Have you noted down? Send me thumbs up for that. Jaldi se. Word meanings ho chuke hain, poem discuss ho chuki hai. We will discuss the literary devices used in the stanza wise. And okay, done. Let me share the screen of and showing you the poem right now. Please note down. In the very first stanza, you can see the screen, beta. Okay, so in the very first stanza, they have used literary devices. Firstly, see, now students are having some network issues. Okay, so firstly, you see, don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. When a word is repeated in the beginning lines of the poem, see, don't bite, don't hunch. So this device is called anaphora, A-N-A-P-H-O-R-A. Fine? Clear? A-N-A-P-H-O-R, anaphora. Anaphora means repeated use of a word at start of two or more lines. Chahe two lines mein ho ya usse zyada lines mein ho. One word is being repeated again and again. That is not the device of repetition. Okay, repetition is something else. One word is repeated in consecutive lines. Okay, first line mein don't aaye, second line mein don't aaye, maybe third mein bhi, fourth mein bhi aa jata. In that way, minimum two, maximum four, five. Fine. Then it is known as anaphora. Then, after that, next poetic device used is metaphor. What is metaphor, Harsimran? Can you tell us? Just speak. What is metaphor? When direct comparison is made, or when we make comparison by using as or like? What is metaphor? Speak, please.
Yes, ma'am.
What is metaphor, beta?
Ma'am, when we make comparison without the use of as or like.
Very good. Clear? So that is metaphor. When comparison is made, direct comparison is made, rather than saying that he's brave like a lion, I can say he's a lion. Fine? In that way, that is metaphor. So emerald sea is the example of metaphor here, because they are using the word emerald rather than the green colored sea. So they are using that, you know, there is one stone which is known as emerald and which is of green color. So rather than using direct words that the sea is of green color, they are saying emerald sea. So emerald sea is the example of metaphor. Please note down. Then repetition is there. Repetition. Now you can get confused that what is the difference between anaphora and repetition. I told you anaphora is when in the beginning of the line a word is being repeated. If I say don't do this, don't do that, don't do the don't word is being repeated in the beginning, then it is called anaphora. But when any word is being repeated anywhere in the stanza, like Amanda, don't bite your nails, Amanda, don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda, why are you doing like this, Amanda? So that is the device of repetition. Clear? So please note down, that is the device of repetition. Then we have next device after this, a sonance. In the first stanza I'm talking about, okay, don't bite se leke drifting blissfully tak kabhi baat kar rahe hain. Assonance, use of vowel sound. Fine. Assonance is when consonant sound is repeated, we call it alliteration. You remember na? If I say beating bubbles bubbling in the bath, B sound is repeated, to wo alliteration ho jata hai. When vowel sound is repeated, what are the vowels? A, E, I, O, U. When five vowels are there in English, fine. When these vowel sounders is repeated, then it is called assonance. A-S-S-O-N-A-N-C-E. Fine. So assonance is used. Clear? Assonance is used. Use of vowel sound O. Where it is used? Don't hunch your shoulders. D-O-H-U, shoulders, S-H-O, fine. So in this line, they have used assonance O-O-O. Your may be O, shoulders may O, don't may be O. Clear? So this is the example of assonance also. Repetition ho gaya and alliteration is also used. Who will tell me where the alliteration is used? Come on, raise your hand. Where the alliteration is in the same stanza, I'm talking about the very first stanza only. Don't bite se leke. Yes. Yes, Divyansh.
Ma'am, stop slouching and sit up straight.
Very good. Very SS. Good. Yes, very good. S sound is repeated. Stop that slouching and sit up straight. S sound is repeated. Stop slouching, sit straight. So this is the example of alliteration. You see in the very first stanza, ek hi stanza mein kitne sare poetic devices used hue. So please note down, okay? Bar bar ye repeat nahi hona hai. The way we do it for the first time when we will do revision, these things won't be into that level, okay? So please note down. So alliteration is used here. We are doing in detail. How much time is left? Let's see. Then next is, let me do it further. Okay, one more. Drifting blissfully. Who will tell me? It is the example of, anybody can tell? You can type in the chat box also. I will announce your name with the correct answer. Drifting blissfully is the example of which poetic device? No one knows. I want quick responses. It is the example of imagery. Okay. So this is example of imagery. Imagery when such picture formation can be there in your minds. So drifting means moving happily with waves. Clear? Fine. Many, many. Mermaid is also, you know, illusion. Mermaid. Oh, mermaid. Then she imagines herself. She compares herself that she is a mermaid. Inhabitant is me, a mermaid. So this is the example of allusion. Please note down. A-L-L-U-S-I-O-N. Because a mermaid is an imaginary creature. When we compare ourselves with imaginary characters, then it is the called, it is known as the poetic device allusion. When a comparison is made with already existing characters. Okay. So this is allusion. Kisi aur ke saath. If I compare myself with the Shakespeare, if I compare myself with some other person who's already existing, that is the example of allusion. So she has compared herself to be a mermaid. So a mermaid is already an existing imaginary character. So this is the example of allusion. A-L-L-U-S-I-O-N. Please note down. So let's move on to next. To almost all the devices we have done. So this is the second stanza. Word meanings we have done, literary devices. Now you tell me, jaldi jaldi batate jao, chat box mein if any device you find, I will announce your name. Anaphora is used again. Anaphora is, I told you, repetition of any word in the beginning. Okay, did you finish? Did you tidy? So this is the example of anaphora. Beginning mein use hua hai, A-N-A-P-H-O-R-A. Clear? Did you finish? Did you tidy? Please note down, anaphora is used here. Then assonance again, use of vowel sound, thought, told, your shoes. Clear? Third line mein, thought, told, your shoes. O sound is being repeated again and again. This is the example of assonance. Then again, repetition of the word Amanda. This is the device of repetition only. Which poetic device is used in first and second line? Amanda. word is being repeated. This is the example of repetition. Then beta, they say silence is golden. Silence is golden is the example of metaphor. They are directly comparing silence with golden. Fine. Said to be glorious like golden color. In that way, they want to say that silence is golden like glorious color, gold color. So the direct comparison is made. This is example of metaphor. Fine. And even you can say example of metaphor is freedom is sweet. Yeah, alag alag metaphors ban sakte hain. Silence is golden, one metaphor. Freedom is sweet, another metaphor. Clear? So we have used anaphora, assonance, repetition, metaphor. Clear? Then next is beta, alliteration is used in the last stanza. Stop that sulking. S sound is repeated. Clear? Stop that sulking. Last me. Last stanza. Stop that sulking. Alliteration is used here. Repetition is again used. Amanda word. Fine. So that's it. I guess all the poetic devices we have discussed. I guess it's clear to you. If any doubt, Vita, you can ask me. Any doubt to anyone in this poem, Amanda? In detail, we have done all the devices. No doubt is there? Fine. So I'm just ending the meet. Time ho chuka hai. And you will answer the questions tomorrow. Okay? Please solve all the question answers. And I will ask you, you will respond to me, and then we will complete this poem. Stanza-wise questions as well as textual questions. Okay, have a nice day.